Jesus Christ is the light of the world. Light, no darkness can overcome. Arise, shine, for your light has come.
Hear now the word of the prophet Zephaniah.
From Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 14 through 17. Sing, O daughter of Zion, shout aloud, O Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The Lord, the King of Israel, is with you. Never again would you fear any harm. On that day, they will say to Jerusalem, Do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands hang limp. The Lord, our God, is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice with you with singing.
Today, as we light the third candle of Advent, we remember that Christ came to bring joy to our world. May this light brighten our hearts with hope and fill our lives with joy.
In the Gospel of Matthew, we read that Jesus was born into the world to save God's people from their sins. This was not what God's people wanted. God's people wanted to be saved from the Romans and all that which demeaned their lives. But Jesus came to save them from their sins, which explains why Jesus' ministry was in large measure resisted by the people of God. The question before us is whether we will still resist that grace, or whether we will, as God's people, come before God, bowing in confession, to meet Christ not with resistance, but with repentance. Together, let us bow before the living God, and using the prayer of confession, confess our sins before God. Let us pray. God of the future, You are coming in power to bring all nations under your rule. We confess that we have not expected your kingdom, for we live casual lives, ignoring your promised judgment. We accept lies as truth, exploit neighbors, abuse the earth, and refuse your justice and peace. In your mercy, forgive us. Grant us wisdom to welcome your way, and to seek things that will endure when Christ comes to judge the world. Brothers and sisters in Christ, Jesus came into the world not to condemn us, but to redeem us. And so hear this good news. In Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
be seated. With the lighting of the Advent candle, we have already heard from the prophet Zephaniah. There are four other biblical texts woven into our worship service today, some from the Old Testament, some from the New, some that you're accustomed to hearing at this time of the year, others not typical texts to be read at the Advent season, Advent and Christmas season. But all of these texts have one thing in common. They point us toward Jesus Christ, the Word, the living Word, the Word made flesh. And so as we consider these texts, and this day the sermon will be brought not by preachers but by choirs, as the message for the day is in the music. And I'll have to tell you, several people at the early service said it's the best sermon they've heard in quite some time. Our first readings are those typically read at this time of the year. We turn first to Isaiah's prophecy, to the 11th chapter. And as we prepare ourselves to hear God's word, let us join together in prayer. Lord God of grace, we give you thanks that you have preserved this word for us throughout the generations. We are grateful, O God, that your word comes to us as truth and power, and that in Jesus Christ your word takes on flesh and dwells among us, that we might see his way and his truth and his life. Continue to guide us by your strong spirit, that we might live lives obedient to him as we seek to serve Christ the Lord all of our days, now and always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. From the 11th chapter of Isaiah's prophecy, hear these words. A shoot shall come out of the stump of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt around his waist, and faithfulness the belt around his loins. The wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the asp, and the weaned child shall put its hand on the adder's den. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Amen. Luke, the gospel writer, also wrote the book of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, so contributed a significant portion to our New Testament. But of all he had ever written was the first part of the second chapter of his gospel. He would be long remembered for preserving this simple but elegant and eloquent depiction of one of the great mysteries of history, God's gift to us in the birth of a child. From the second chapter of Luke's gospel, listen again to God's word for us. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be enrolled. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I am bringing you good news of a great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God shall abide forever. Amen.
return to the Old Testament with our scripture lesson from the book of Isaiah, chapter 35, verses 1 through 10. Let us hear the word of the Lord. The return of the redeemed to Zion. The wilderness and the dry land shall be glad. The desert shall rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it shall blossom abundantly and rejoice with joy and singing. The glory of Lebanon shall be given to it, the majesty of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Strengthen the weak hands and make firm the feeble knees. Say to those who are of a fearful heart, be strong, do not fear. Here is your God. He will come with vengeance, with terrible recompense. He will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like a deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The haunt of jackals shall become a swamp. The grass shall become reeds and rushes. A highway shall be there, and it shall be called the Holy Way. The unclean shall not travel on it, for it shall be for God's people. No traveler, not even fools, shall go astray. No lion shall be there, nor shall any ravenous beast come up on it. They shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk there. And the ransomed of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with singing. Everlasting joy shall be upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
In this reading from Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, John the Baptizer asks a profound question. John summoned two of his disciples and sent them to the Lord to ask, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" When the men had come to him, they said, "John the Baptist has sent us to you to ask, 'Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?'" Jesus had just then cured many people of diseases, plagues, and evil spirits, and had given sight to many who were blind. And he answered them, "Go and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you. Now would you respond by affirming your faith as we stand and respond to the word proclaimed in word and music using the words of the Apostles' Creed, affirming what we believe about the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Let us say what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Please be seated. One pastoral concern to bring to your attention. John Long had back surgery this week, and John is recovering at home. A couple of calendar announcements on the back of the bulletin. You can see the midweek service has some special music in it this Wednesday. Sheila Barrick will be the speaker, and the Child Development Center children will be singing with the Helen Ayers leading them this Wednesday, kind of an annual thing they do. Reminder, this Wednesday, the session and diaconate meet together, and we still have a few officers yet to examine. You will notice on Saturday, it says the Christmas drop-in at the McLeods. It shows a starting time of 4 o'clock. Implicit in that are two other things. There's a stopping time of 7 o'clock, and it's a drop-in, drop-out, because everybody's invited. All of us, all your friends, anticipating a little overflow crowd. Ed's put a storage shed up outside, but anyway, park at the parking lot for a White Memorial Church and walk around to Davis Street for the great adventure. Everybody at the McLeods at once, and Jenny's gonna be working hard even on her birthday the day before. One thing that's not on the calendar that I would call your attention to: Monday the 20th is the annual Presbyterian Women and Presbyterian Men dinner. Martha Crisp will prepare a wonderful Italian dinner. We're going to have a jazz band, and everything's looking good. $9 for that. You do need to make reservations, and so far only 34 of us have done that. So either turn in a card today or call the church office. Also that night, we'll be honoring Frank Brooks, retiring from a long term of service to the church. Bill Alexander is moderator of the mission committee as an elder, and I'd like to have a word with you about an annual mission project.
Presbyterians have long celebrated the birth of Christ by giving a Christmas joy offering. Please join me in taking an envelope in your pew and making a generous contribution. The Christmas joy offering is divided by the General Assembly, and half goes to support Presbyterian colleges that are historically Black, Native American, and Hispanic. Seven college total, five which are supported are in the South, two in the Southwest, one is in North Carolina. This gift provides those colleges basic operating costs, and it also provides scholarships for deserving students. The other half of the joy gift goes to former ministers, missionaries, church workers, and their families. This money is used to supplement inadequate retirement income, provide supplemental medical insurance, and pay nursing home care assistance. It also can meet unexpected financial needs or help them to recover from a natural disaster. In short, it allows those who have been faithful Presbyterian servants to modestly maintain their dignity. Our gift this morning allows us to show our appreciation to those who have given their lifetime to the church in the service of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Did this morning's music remind you of when you were learning to play an instrument and you practiced your part at home? It didn't sound very good, especially if you were third trumpet. But then remember the first time when the orchestra all began to play together and you felt that chill up your back. You realized you were something a part of much larger than yourself. It was invigorating and it was probably humbling as well to be part of such magnificent music. In the quotation at the top of our worship bulletin, William Temple says that adoration, such as raising this magnificent music in praise to God, adoration is the most selfless of all emotions. Let us come before God to pray in adoration and thanksgiving. Great God, we have gathered here today to focus on you. We came here hoping to have our hearts lifted by the glorious music, by the marvelous story we never tire of hearing. The story of how you took on human form and came into the world as one of us to demonstrate your reconciling love for us once and for all. Help us to believe we could be that lovable. Help us to live as redeemed people. And in this Advent time of preparation, help us to continue to prepare for a Savior and to take on his characteristics, to live as those who do not judge by appearance, to be understanding people at peace with all, continuing to do our part in ushering in your kingdom. Lord, with the humble shepherds, let us stand humbly in awe, not afraid of the good news that God is with us, has a mission for us, and will use us to change the world by spreading the good news first announced by the angels so long ago. May we be your agents of peace and reconciliation in this troubled world. Lord, may that light of hope that's coming into the world bring hope to those in its darkest corners, rekindling the spirits of the dispirited, the downtrodden, and the disadvantaged. We pray in one voice now as our loving Savior would have us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
In the name of Jesus Christ, welcome to this time of worship. If you're visiting with us or a member of the church, either one, we hope you'll sign the friendship sheets as they pass along the pew to you. If you just happen to show up here to visit with us today, you've chosen a good Sunday, and now hopefully you understand why this particular service is a highlight of this church's celebration of the Advent and Christmas season. If you are looking for a church home, we'd be delighted to extend a welcome to you. If you'd like to talk more about that, you can talk to one of the pastors or church members, or indicate that on the friendship sheet, and we'll be back in touch with you. At this time, let us all worship God as we bring God's gifts, as we bring God's tithes and our offering.
Thank you.
us pray. Lord God of grace, you have richly blessed us this day, and we have sought to be a blessing to you. And so we bring our gifts before your throne of grace, seeking to devote ourselves to you, to commit ourselves to you, to offer ourselves as living sacrifices, that your name might be praised in us and through us, even to the ends of the earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. There is a wonderful hymn in our hymn book which begins with the words, "When in our music God is glorified." These musicians and choirs have sought to do just that this day, seeking through our music to glorify God. Now it is our turn, the rest of the day, the rest of the week, the rest of our lives, to seek when in our lives God is glorified. For that's why we are here. That's when we have understood our vocation, our reason and purpose for living, to be that which God has called us to be, faithful people who seek always and only to glorify the living God. So go out into the world seeking to do just that. And may God's grace, mercy, and peace guide, direct, and bless you now and forevermore through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.